Hi everyone, my name is Samna Batul and today I am presenting my paper along with my co-authors from University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, Lahore University of Management Sciences and Information Technology University from Pakistan. If we talk about maternal mortality situation in Pakistan with a population of 212 million people, around 178 per 100,000 women die each year due to complications related to pregnancy. If we talk about medical causes of maternal mortality, it includes abortion, high blood pressure, bleeding disorder, obstetric labor, and infection after delivery. Along with these medical causes, there are certain non-medical causes as well that are leading towards maternal morbidity and mortality, including early marriages, limited education, lack of skilled birth attendant, and delays in seeking medical care. And these are the determinants that have been studied very well in the literature. Apart from that, there are two major other causes that that are there in Pakistan that leads to maternal mortality. These are limited agency of women while deciding for their pregnancy health and the religious beliefs that we have in Pakistan. So the purpose of our study was to examine the opportunities and challenges in designing any intervention, any maternal health intervention for low-income and low-literate communities with the patriarchal and religious context. So for the purpose of our study, we conducted interviews in the primary healthcare system. So in Punjab, there are three levels of healthcare system. The first one is primary care, the second one is secondary care, and the third one is tertiary care. Primary care is a very basic and initial level of care that is being given to the community, and the staff that is there in the primary care health facilities, which include health houses and basic health units. So the staff is have very limited training and we don't have any specialized staff available at the primary care. So they usually refer their patients to the secondary care that have more equipment and more educated medical personnel as compared to the primary healthcare system. But again, they are not equipped enough to handle major cases, which they further refer to tertiary care, which includes teaching hospitals. So we conducted our interviews in the primary healthcare system. The purpose of conducting these interviews at the very basic level was to interact with the community directly and with the lady health workers who are interacting with the community and counseling them on their maternal health situation and other health-related problems. And among the teaching care, among the tertiary care, we interviewed expert gynecologists and again, women who were expecting mothers who were admitted in the ward. In total, we interviewed 61 expecting mothers, 24 medical professionals, and 8 family members of expecting mothers. The type of interaction that we had in our study was a roundtable discussion. First of all, the purpose of conducting that roundtable discussion with the gynecologists and lady health workers was to understand the current maternal health situation in Pakistan so that we can design our semi-structured interviews accordingly. After that, we conducted 43 semi-structured interviews with expecting mothers. With expecting mothers and 6 health professionals. Apart from that, we conducted 3 health sessions. 3 health sessions with the purpose of conducting these health sessions was that while conducting semi-structured interviews, we found out like there are certain things that expecting mothers want to know from gynecologists. So that's why we conducted these sessions in which we provided a platform to expecting mothers to talk to gynecologists directly. And apart from that, we had focus group discussion with the community health workers to understand that what kind of traditional practices that are being followed by these expecting mothers in the community. These are the demographic details of expecting mothers, along with the technology usage of expecting mothers, and these are the demographic details of medical experts that we interviewed during the course of our study. Among the findings, we found out two major things that are impacting maternal health situation in Pakistan. The first one is traditional practices, which includes religious therapies and spiritual healing. The second one is the family dynamics that is impacting maternal health situation in Pakistan, with the limited agency of expecting mothers to decide for their health during pregnancy. First, we'll talk about traditional practices. In Pakistan, so there are two concepts when we talk about traditional practices. The first one is the dua, which is prayer, and the second one is dawa, which is medicine. In medicine, we have antenatal care visits, iron and calcium intakes, and these kind of things. Whereas in dua, which is prayer, we have a spiritual leader, who is usually a male personality with religious knowledge, who perform religious therapies. So what kind of religious therapies they perform? It includes two types of religious therapies. The first one is an amulet, which is a piece of paper with some Quranic verses written on that piece of paper, which they give to expecting mother. And the second one is dam, which is the recitation of Quranic verses, and they blow it over water or sugar and then give it to expecting mother to consume it regularly during pregnancy. And they consume these things regularly in pregnancy till the 9 months, and then they pass on these things to the newborn after delivery. So the reason of conducting these religious therapies is to prevent expecting mothers from evil eye, to find a solution of infertility, to give birth of a son. And another thing that was very common in Pakistan was a term that used by the community, which we call, which is athra. So usually athra, they refer miscarriages or recurrent pregnancy loss as athra, and they have a firm belief that these religious therapies, that only religious therapies can prevent them from athra. So they follow all these religious therapies regularly. They go to a religious therapist regularly. So when you talk about religious therapies, there are some benign religious therapies and there are some non-benign religious therapies. For example, a mother-in-law told us that my neighbor's daughter-in-law had athra, and while she was taking a bath, my daughter-in-law happened to step across the open sewer lines of their house and also got infected. So I took her to a religious therapy and strictly instructed her not to go anywhere until she delivers a baby. So that's a non-benign. That's a benign practice that is not harming expecting mother in any way. Similarly, not only expecting mothers follow these benign religious therapies, but there are midwives as well that we encountered during the course of our study who follow these religious therapies. For example, a midwife told us, a religious therapist told me that I'm suffering from athra in my third month. He gave me a bottle of water and instructed me to drink it in small sips until next morning and my pain will go away. I drank it overnight and within 3 to 4 hours, I was relieved. So when we talked about when we talked to medical professionals, including gynecologists and other medical experts, about their perception of these religious therapies. So a medical expert told us that when people come to us and say they have athra and they need religious therapy, we never say no to them, because if we stop them from religious therapy, from these religious practices, they will never come to us or listen to us. So what these medical experts do, they tell them to follow these religious therapies as long as it is not harmful for the expecting mothers. And then they ask them to come to a basic health unit or to a health facility regularly as well. So they are taking both systems side by side, because they know if they are going to tell them to not follow these religious therapies for any reason, then they will see a backward reaction of these expecting mothers, because they know that they are not going to come to health facilities who stop them from following these religious therapies. So apart from these benign practices, there are certain non-benign practices as well. For example, an expecting mother told us that I will go for natural birth spacing after 2 sons, but will not go for a ligation because it's a sin. I have heard that our prayers will go in vain after ligation. I have heard from this So callers that it is prohibited in Islam to stop the birth procedure permanently because Allah will get offended. So they have this thing in mind that ligation or a use of contraception is prohibited in Islam. And similarly, when it comes to cesarean, they prefer not to go for a cesarean because they think it's prohibited in Islam. And that's why when doctors tell them that they need a cesarean after, for example, 5 or 6 deliveries, then they prefer unauthorized midwives rather than medical professionals, because they know that these unauthorized midwives will try their best to deliver a normal baby because they don't want to go against their religious norms, because they think that these things are prohibited in Islam. apart from family dynamics, apart from religious therapies, there are complex family dynamics. For example, mother-in-law are the in charge. In some cases, husbands are the in charge. And women have limited to no agency to decide for their pregnancy, which leads to either death of a mother or death of a baby. For example, an expecting mother told us that I wanted to go for an operation after my fourth delivery, but couldn't do so because my husband wasn't in hospital and my mother-in-law refused to sign the consent form as my husband has the decision power. Now I'll do it after fifth delivery and hopefully my husband will be here. So they don't have the agency to decide for themselves. They either have to ask permission from their mother-in-laws in some cases and from their husbands in other cases. And these mother-in-laws accompany their expecting mothers whenever they go for an antenatal care checkup or whenever they go for a religious therapy, because they want to know that what kind of treatment is given to them, and then they want to because they have the authority, so they'll decide accordingly if they want to continue that specific treatment for their daughter-in-laws or not. So in conclusion, we found out like that women have limited agency. They are unable to decide for themselves. It's either husbands or mother-in-laws who are deciding. And then we found out that expecting mothers have limited source of information, and these limited source of information are religious, are follow religious norms. So they're left with only one option, and that is to follow the religious beliefs that is being religious and cultural beliefs that is being followed in Pakistan. And then these religious practices have a deep impact on maternal health and religious. And then we have seen that these medical professionals are actually using these religious therapies to encourage expecting mothers and their family members to come for an antenatal care checkup and to come for a hospital for regular care during pregnancy. And then we found out that expecting mothers have a blind faith on any information that they are able to acquire online sources. We saw that only 7 expecting mothers had access to online information, and because of their limited education, they tend to follow everything that they see online and with very strong adverse without asking anybody. That has very strong adverse effect sometimes. So based on these findings, we have certain recommendations that is based on Sultana et al. Framework to design in a patriarchal context that is empowered within, not against. So we need to incorporate these medical professionals into our systems because they are already leveraging these religious therapies to convince community to come for a medical care as well. Enable such situated tactics, as we have seen that our community is religiously following these practices, these religious practices, so we can't eliminate these things from a system while designing a technical intervention or any sort of intervention for expecting mothers, and then design beyond users. We have to incorporate expecting mothers and their husband and expecting, we have to incorporate mother-in-laws and husband into a system while designing any system for expecting mother for maternal care, because we know that women have limited agency. And if we are going to design any system that in which we don't include mother-in-laws or husbands, we know for sure that it is not going to work in a religious and patriarchal context like Pakistan. So that is all from our side. If you have any other questions, please feel free to reach out to us, and we'll happy to answer your queries. Thank you so much.